time to order the prior business.
Tenet told us that in his world, quote, the system was blinking red, close quote. And by late July, it could not have been any worse.
Good morning, America. I'm Charles Gibson.
I'm Diane Sawyer, and it's Tuesday, September 11th, 2001.
In August, the FBI learned that there were two terrorists whose names we had who were clearly here to kill Americans.
It is beautiful outside, perfect September day with lots of sunshine. Oh, would you look at Washington? I'm going outside today.
Let me read you some of the actual chatter that was picked up in that spring and summer. Unbelievable news coming in weeks. Big event. There will be a very, 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 very big uproar.
Other than that, it's kind of quiet around the country. We like quiet. It's too quiet.
American 11, Boston. American 11, the American on the frequency. How do you hear me? Is that American 11 trying to call?
We have some planes. Just stay quiet and you'll be okay. We're turning to the airport.
About apparently a
plane crashed into the South Tower of the
World Trade Center.
Kennedy Tower reports that there was a fire at the World Trade Center, and that's the area where we lost the airplane.
Difficult moment for America.
Apparently, there was an explosion of some kind here at the Pentagon.
Oh my goodness, there is smoke pouring out of the Pentagon.
People who came out were told and ordered by the Secret Service to run.
I'm in front of the Capitol, and a moment ago, police officers ran up to us and told us, and I quote, there is a plane that has been hijacked and is headed this way.
You can see the firemen assembled here, the police officers, FBI agents, and you can see the two towers. A huge explosion now, raining debris on all of us. We better get out of the way.
Looks like a new large plume of smoke.
Oh my God! Oh my God!
We have in. This is from Somerset County, Pennsylvania.
Good evening. Today, our fellow citizens, our way of life, our very freedom came under attack in a series of deliberate and deadly terrorist acts.
We were surprised. We were unprepared. We failed. And we failed in a horrible way.
In the aftermath of the attacks, we rallied as a nation to rescue survivors, bury the dead, increase our vigilance.
Security measures were intensified across the board, and moving forward, air travel as we know it has changed forever.
We responded.
It was an attack the world was anticipating. The United States had always warned the events of September 11 would not go unanswered.
Then we investigated.
That's the official start of our first public hearing of what is going to be an extraordinarily difficult and important job.
There have been scores of films about the attacks and the plot behind them. But not a single one is about the nine men and one woman who investigated the attacks. The story of the 9/11 Commission is truly remarkable for a number of reasons. For example, had it not been for the tenacity of the 9/11 families, there never would have been a commission.
For 18 months, our family has been denied the truth that a thorough investigation would reveal. As a family member, I am frustrated to have suffered the loss of a son and yet to be required to spend time away from my family and fight for the establishment of a commission that should have been in place on the day of the tragic event.
Congress had decided only to probe the activities of the intelligence community, but the 9/11 families demanded a comprehensive investigation. And they kept the pressure on until an independent commission was formed.
My name is Beverly Eckert. I lost my husband, Sean Rooney. He was killed on September 11th, South Tower. We're going to continue what we've been doing in order to make sure that this commission not only finds the truth, but the reforms are implemented. We're in this for the long haul.
The 9/11 Commission conducted the largest government investigation in U.S. history. They interviewed 1,200 people around the world, reviewed 2.5 million documents, conducted 18 public hearings, and their report was an accessible, comprehensive history of the attacks and a series of recommendations for our future.
We think the commission in many ways was set up to fail because we had not enough money. We didn't have enough time. We'd been appointed by the most partisan people in Washington, the leaders of the House and Senate. We were appointed in the most partisan year that the country may have ever had going into a presidential election.
Then there was the commission's remarkable success. Tom Kaine and Lee Hamilton committed to shedding partisanship and following the facts wherever they led.
We just put aside and didn't permit really partisan considerations.
Lee and I worked on it hard. We worked on it very hard to do bipartisan. It wasn't the first time Meet the Press called me and asked me to appear, and I talked to Lee and I said, I'll appear if you have Lee Hamilton with me. And Tim Russert people basically said, we don't let guests pick guests. And I said, then get somebody else.
We are members of different parties, but the fact of the matter is, if you put 10 honorable people in a room and you tell them to work through a hard problem, you're gonna see a lot less partisanship in the end than people would expect.
This bipartisan commitment was embraced so much by the other commissioners that when Democrat Commissioner Jamie Gorelick was verbally attacked in a public hearing, Republican commissioners stepped up to defend her in the hearing and in the media.
Jamie Gorelick was one of her top deputies who bought into this entirely. The message was sent, if you have stuff overseas, intelligence overseas, don't bother us with it.
Nothing Jamie Gorelick wrote had the slightest impact on the Department of Defense or its willingness or ability to share intelligence information with other intelligence agencies.
All right, we'll let the audience decide.
Then there are the commission's remarkable recommendations. While they address some issues that were specific only to the 2000s, most are even more relevant today than they were when they were published.
We made 41 recommendations. A number of them have been enacted into law. A number of them have been ignored.
Counterterrorism policy must be the number one priority for any president for the foreseeable future.
So many things went wrong that day, but so much that followed went right. Passengers on Flight 93 voted to take back the plane and save others. The families transformed tragic suffering into public good. And leaders from both parties worked together to show us the right way to tackle tough problems.
I rely on your recommendations every day. None of that would have been possible without the leadership provided by Tom and Lee. You come from different parts of our great country. Tom's a proud citizen of the Garden State, and Lee is a quintessential Hoosier who first made his name on the basketball court. But both of you embody what Americans want in their public servants: integrity, humility, intelligence, and a commitment to put the interests of our country before any partisan or personal agenda.
Are We Safer Today will reconvene the members of the commission for only the second time since 2004. Together, they'll discuss what they learned, what they recommended, and how we stand today.
Join with us to tell this inspiring story on public television. Are We Safer Today? September 2021.